I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Today is Monday, November 3rd, 2014. The time is 7 a.m. The regular meeting of the Greensburg IN City Council is called to order. It's time to silence the recording devices. Roll call, please.
Blake.
Here.
Glenn.
Here.
Terry.
Here.
Darrel.
Here.
James.
Here.
Thank you. We have minutes from October 6th, the regular meeting. Do you see any corrections or amendments? No, I've got to entertain a motion to accept the minutes as you receive them for the October 6th meeting.
I'll make one.
Second. Any further discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, same sign. Old business, new business, community action coalition.
Yes, good evening. I'm Jenny Hanna, and here this evening with Kim Linkle and Tina Hoeing. We're here on behalf of the Community Action Coalition, better known as CAC. Hopefully you're familiar with the CAC. Our mission is to help reduce drug, alcohol, and tobacco use in the county, especially among our youth. We are probably best known for things such as our role model posters that feature some of the high school kiddos. We help to fund the local SAD groups. We have purchased police equipment for both the county and the city, various things like that. Also, I guess among our council members here this evening and officially are Stacy Chastain and Bill Myers. They're also on our council. We are here this evening because we are in the ninth out of a 10-year grant. We are currently on the ninth year of a 10-year federal grant, which is basically what has funded us over the last 9 years to do many of the projects that we've been working on throughout the county. That federal grant, the county has been serving as the fiscal agent for us over the course of the last 9 years. As we are winding down in that grant, we are looking at the possibility of reapplying for that grant. Again, it's a federal grant. But in the process of reapplying, we are going to need a new fiscal agent, and so we come to you this evening asking if the city would be willing to serve as our fiscal agent. We have had talked with Bridget a little bit about the possibility of doing that. Of course, Bridget was our primary contact when she was at the county, so she's very familiar with the process of this federal grant. It's actually called a federal drug-free communities grant, and Bridget was initially the go-to person for us at the county. So she is familiar with that and is willing to take on the duties if you are willing to serve as a fiscal agent for us, should we go ahead and apply for that. Now the application date for that would be, ladies, what year?
Probably like the end of March, this time in 2015.
And notification would be?
Like the fall.
It would be September.
The grant would actually start October 1st of 2015, if you are willing.
That is basically what we are here this evening asking is for your assistance in helping us continue our mission and serving as our fiscal agent so that we can continue doing some of the good things that we're doing in the county. Any questions?
Questions for Bridget.
We would just act as their bank. Basically, when the federal funds come in, they would just be filtered into the city. You keep track of it separately. Any kind of grant applications that they honor, any kind of daily operation bills or anything like that, we would write the checks for them. They're not a 501c3, so they have to have someone act as their fiscal agent.
I think it's a relatively routine practice, and I have no problem with the city serving that capacity.
Councilman,
you're reapplying for a new grant.
Correct.
So this year, you're in the ninth, and you guys under the
actually, October was.
Yeah,
The start of the 10th, yes, sorry.
Yes, we are in the final.
When you were telling me that not the date, you didn't.
Yeah, we are, we just started the final.
It's a fiscal year.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah, I misspoke, it's the 9th year.
That's fine.
I was off a year.
Seems like it's easy for me to do, I mean, I'll do it. I'll do it.
You're just gonna be making a decision whatever your money goes for.
Yeah.
And there is a budget that is submitted with the grant and an action plan to what outlines specifically what the coalition would be doing throughout the next, it's a 12-month action plan that's submitted each year with the budget, so it would all be approved by ONDCP and SAMHSA are the two overarching agencies that oversee the drug-free communities and work.
So all we would do is just put the state funds, the federal funds, whatever.
Yeah, the federal funds.
Or what?
Yeah, and basically the way those funds come in, because I have different grants come in different ways. They actually, and I don't know, Bridget actually was one of the people that could also go in, but basically you go in and show how much you need to draw down. So if your claim were paid on Monday, you could go in on Friday and draw that amount down, and then you would go right back out that Monday. So it's not like, there would never be any, a time that you guys would have to upfront any money. They pull it down and then go for it.
So we just issue one check, take care of them?
No, I think that she would write all the checks.
Yeah, she would write all the checks.
Yeah.
I see.
Yeah.
As the bills come in, I draw the money down, transfer it to the account, and then she just.
Counselor, do you need to act?
I would, yes, I would ask for a motion to accept the responsibilities as fiscal agent for this organization and their upcoming grant application.
So I would entertain a motion to the city of Greensburg to become fiscal agent for the grant of Greensburg IN City Council. I'd like that motion.
Second.
Any further discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
All same sign.
Thank you.
Next item, city engineer Gary Murray. Darrel agricultural zoning classification ordinance 2014-17.
We've been working with the planning commission and a subcommittee to come up with an agricultural zoning classification within the city limits. The way it's written is that zoning request must accompany a voluntary annexation request. If they were agricultural in the county, they could come into the city as being agricultural. We did not have, currently do not have an agricultural zoning classification. That before you was presented to the planning commission, and they made unanimous positive recommendation to use the board for approval.
Of course, Councilman Tevye, Councilman O'Meara, were on the planning commission. So would you guys like to address this?
Well, as Gary said, it was brought to our attention that some people may voluntarily like to come into the city and at the same time not pay the full tax rate of the city services. So for that to happen, we have to create an agricultural district. That gets appealing for them.
More appealing.
Yeah, for them to come into the city. As we said, though, it's a completely voluntary move by the landowners of each of these parcels.
I think this is primarily designed to be a temporary classification. So that it's, because within a certain amount of time after annexation, you have to provide city, whose laws require us to have a plan for services and utilities and all kinds of development of it to be part of the city. So I would think that what we're looking at here is a temporary thing that would allow for marketing of property. And in the meantime, you have to remain agricultural for it. If it ever comes to the point that it's not, it remains agricultural in a definite way, I suppose that's possible, but we have to start taking a look at the requirements of the law, how we would go about doing that, and then make some adjustments as we go. So at this point in time, I don't see any reason not to do it, because it could provide for economic development opportunities down the way in the near term, not driving in the near term. So I wouldn't be advising it if I thought we were going to have to obligate ourselves for utilities and other kinds of things in the long term without indefinite development plans where you have a development company that wants to come in and develop, like we do when we annex other places, help provide the roads and the sewers and the water and all that. And there was an effort to do that in a collaborative manner between developers and the city.
And this proposal was posted to the website the day after the Land Commission made a positive recommendation to this body, and I've received no phone calls or any questions concerning it out there. So I think we're just looking for first reading.
I wouldn't want us to hurry this. My knowledge is there in emergency to do it. And I think it does need to be, give us some time to think it over. As well as, you know, have a public comment that will come and resolve this, or make time.
Make the motion we pass ordinance 2014-17 on first reading.
Second.
Any further discussion?
Well, I guess I'm just thinking out loud, and I'm not saying no, I'm just thinking out loud. So we're going to provide increased fire service, we're going to provide increased police service, we're going to provide additional services, and we're basically going to receive no taxes for those areas and still provide additional services to cover, right?
No, exactly.
Okay. I mean, if they change the scope of their land from, then yes, but other than that, they're paying county taxes, they won't be paying for city taxes.
We can abate them over a 3-year period. After that, it will go to the full city rate.
Okay, all right.
And also, Jamie, the area that we're really looking at, people have already asked to be annexed, and we did in probably February, March 2008. They're already annexed into the city in that area. And we're trying to make it worth the while or effort to come forward and be annexed voluntarily among their neighbors that have asked. Something else, I, in my time, Councilman Timmy was on the council years before that. I don't recollect any forced annexation the city of Greensburg has done in years, and that's not our intent at all. This is just making a better business situation, economic development situation, better for the city and property owners as well.
Raise a point in what Gary is saying. We do have areas within our city that are currently
county.
Well, they're county, but we also have areas within our city that are inside the city limits, not just drawn around them, but inside the city limits that have been asked to be annexed, who are paying the higher thing. I foresee somebody go back and say, "Now wait a minute. Those other properties now." So I don't know what we're going to do about that. But that's the point. And we're talking about abating over a 3-year period. So I'm assuming that the first year would be a sizable abatement, but the second and third year wouldn't be. That would be reduced so that you could, the abatement could be structured in a number of ways, I suppose. But so we would have some income off of that
on the increase. As the abatement is decreased, then there would be some payment of city tax, additional city tax on that property. And we talked about that also very openly at the plan commission. The question was raised, well, what about places within the city? What could say, well, I want to be agricultural instead of business three or industrial or whatever it is that's zoned that way, but it's farm, for example. On bypass, but I'm doing 421 going north. Well, that properties there are crops on them, along with next to the spot that's where we put Veterans Way in and so forth. That's all in city. That's all used as agricultural. But it was pointed out that this ordinance clearly states that this can only be applied on new annexations and not retroactive. So that's, at least that's the opinion of the legal counsel we got.
Did a lot of discussion or not, but if you'll remember, when we were doing the Gas Creek project, this board approved roughly $105,000 to submit to DNR and FEMA for revising the floodplain mapping after the Gas Creek project was completed. We did not lower the 100-year flood elevation as much as we thought north of the Main Street Bridge. We have been working with NDOT, the governor's office, and everything trying to get Main Street Bridge over Gas Creek replaced sooner rather than later. NDOT had a program for 2019. We, through our efforts, have gotten them to move that up 3 years to 2016. The only problem is if they replace that culvert, then we would be doing this work again if we decide to go ahead and submit to FEMA to get the number of parcels and structures out of the floodplain right now, because NDOT won't go through that step. So our floodplain maps are updated from the 1983 maps last year in October. And I've listed all the addresses of properties that have either part of the parcel in the floodplain currently and whether or not the structure's in the floodplain. And you can go through a process, it's called a letter map revision, which costs about $1,000 with the local surveyor, where he can go and shoot the elevation of the lowest adjacent opening next to a structure. If that is higher than what they used to call the 100-year flood, which now they call the 1% annual chance of flood, then you submit that to FEMA, and FEMA will give you a letter that says to your bank, if you have a mortgage, you can remove the structure from the required flood insurance. Typically, if they're a lender, and I would do the same thing, they would say, if the lot's partially within, we're saying everything's within, and you're going to pay flood insurance. Well, with all the Superstorm Sandy and Katrina and everything else, FEMA is $20 billion in debt. So the Congress came and said, well, you can't borrow from the Treasury anymore. You now have to be self-sufficient in your premiums. So people's premiums are jumping through the roof. And so that last summer, they amended that bill to say that they couldn't increase people's flood insurance premiums more than 19% a year for 5 years, which essentially doubles it. So who knows what else is going to happen? I did a comparison between what the 83 maps were, not the 83 maps, the 2013 maps, which put some additional people in, which I didn't quite understand because they didn't redo any hydrology or modeling or head grass. But there's some people that were on the west side of Nightingale that were not in that 83 map, but are now in the 2013 map. Up in that area with what we did with gas, we were able to lower that 100-year flood elevation by about a foot and a half, which gets quite a few structures out, as you can see, between the two different columns. 64. About 64 structures have the ability now to hire a surveyor and have that done about $1,000, and then they wouldn't pay flood insurance anymore. But if we go ahead and get the maps changed, then we need to appropriate some money down the road in 2020 or 2018 when the bridge is done and we can do an as-built of the bridge and the opening and put that back in model and submit that back to FEMA if we don't pull back now. So,
correct me if I'm wrong, but these 64 homes, you know, structures that are out, if they do it themselves, they can get it done a lot faster. I have a survey out.
Yes.
Now, if we submit it like we originally intended to do, it's going to take how long?
Usually to get through FEMA for a big area like that is 12 to 18 months. We're talking redoing the whole map, not just saying, my house is here and the 100-year flood elevation is here, and have that state by an engineer survey. So
the main thing we're looking at, the structures that have been removed, those are the people that could go and have surveyed and be removed. Some people are paying as much, they mark $1,000 to $5,000 a year in flood insurance. It would be to their benefit to do this and be taken out as soon as possible.
Well, we would need to submit our study, because our study is what drives that. And if the only map that's official is the one that's published by FEMA.
And by the official map that was published in 2013?
In October of 2013.
Then there are some people that proceeded because their house structure was not in, and they've chosen to do that.
But we can't get these 64 out unless we submit. I mean, they could still take a chance, but they're still going to go with the old 100-year flood elevation, not the one that is lowered by a foot and a half,
so
because of what
saying,
we did.
You're still saying it's still going to be a year and a half before this can happen?
If we decided to submit right now.
If not, people could be taken out in a year and a half, is now going to wait until 2018 or 19.
They may be waiting 5 years to get out.
That's a lot of money for those people.
I just didn't know what the council felt about potentially another $50,000 or $60,000 to go through this exercise again. It's not going to be the whole 105 that was appropriated this first time, but it'll be $60,000 to $75,000 probably to go through the exercise for a second time.
You know, council, I know it's a lot of money, and $50,000 or $60,000 is a lot to spend. You know what team. Sooner we can work to get these people, these parcels out of the floodplain to really get done a lot quicker. They're still going to make investment, correct? You know, we get the flood maps changed where the structure's out, they're still going to have to.
They may have to, yes.
If we don't do something now, we're delaying what's going to have to be done anyway, 5 years from now.
Okay.
Considerable, right?
3 feet south of Main Street,
yes. But
with what was done, there still is a foot and a half north of Main Street that this affects.
Could potentially be lowered.
By a foot and a half.
By a foot, an additional foot and a half, if NDOT creates an opening.
So, 13 to the new figures.
That'd be 3 feet from 2013.
It'd be 3 feet from the 2013. It's down about a foot and a half north of Main Street with just the Gas Creek project.
And that's what we're trying to document. That's what we're documenting.
That's what we're documenting here.
Right, and that's what we're documenting here, which will enable people to seek that clarification to see if they can get.
Only if we get ours approved through FEMA. Because the only official map is the current map, and until we get it changed, that's the only thing that.
So the work we've done up to this point is moved unless we move forward.
Correct.
Has the stuff south of the bridge, has that been submitted? Is it on and on its way to getting approved?
We just got the final approval from DNR.
So.
And once we get DNR's
first step. If we don't do this side, we're going to do that side?
I wouldn't do either one. There's only two structures downstream of Main Street that it affects.
I truly think that what we've done would be in pain for another 5 years if we don't do something now. We've already made the investment. Council already approved it. If we submit it now, and it even takes a year and a half, that's still going to be 5 years, 3.5 years sooner that could be maybe removed than what would be the government.
Is it just guaranteed? That this will take place in 4 or 5 years?
The culvert being enlarged is the engineering company's already been hired to design the new culvert. And there's other things that has to be on the environmental assessments, things like that, does take time. So for us to be put on the list to be done in 2 years, and start 2 years or so, 3 years and start construction, I think that's been quite an accomplishment. Do that and not the middle of this.
Yeah, anytime you use federal funds, they dictate pretty much the schedule. So, because it's a creek, you're going to deal with fish and wildlife, you're going to deal with the Corps of Engineers, you're going to deal with IDEM, you're going to deal with right of way issues. There's a whole host of things that need to be vetted out before. But they have said that they found the money to do it. They moved it up on their program from 2019 to 2016 money, which really starts in July of 2015.
So, I understand on the project in 2018 or whatever the state's schedule, but if we go forward with this, the state comes through with what they're telling us they're going to come through, is this guaranteed that these people are out of that plane at that point?
Which people? The 64, what Gary's done is done his own assessment. And this is the closest estimate that we can come to the 64. Now, when we lower another foot and a half, there's going to be more structures come out than what's already there. And there'll be more structures and lots, parcels that will be completely taken out according to the flood maps. Now, when that happens, both of them are taken out, they don't have to do anything, right?
Right.
The ones who still, the property is in, but the structure's out, they would still have to go have a survey and apply to have it removed.
That's what we're trying
to time on that. That's what you're saying, it's 2 to 3 years?
Well, there's approximately, it's not.
I haven't gone and looked at every house and see if they've got a little door for a crawl space that's going to get wet.
But there's approximately 60 or 64 structures. If we apply now, a year and a half from now, the new map comes out.
What's the timing on that?
That would be construction hopefully in 2018.
2018, and we probably submit in 2019. And then you're 12 to 18 months.
So then you're looking 2019 or year 2020 before the second group could apply and take. And if we don't do anything now,
it'll be everybody will be waiting that length of period of time. Meanwhile, people paying $1,000, $5,000 a year in flood insurance, and some of those people will be removed 3 years sooner.
The study we've done, we appropriated so much money for it. How much have we spent of that?
$100 out of $105.
How much is it going to cost to submit this in now?
The balance of the $5,000.
I think it might be $30, Gary.
Whatever it is. So it's a relatively minor amount. So we've got the work done.
Correct.
And when we have to, if when the bridge is done, we're still going to have to resubmit those.
You're going to have to start over again.
And we're going to spend another. So we're going to spend the money a second time anyway.
Well, these are $60,000 right here.
Right. Yeah. You're going to have to spend it again. We've wasted it if we don't do something with it now. My point is, as I understand it, we just no result. We might as well get some result from it. If we've already spent $100,000, I think $5,000 or $10,000 more.
It's not completely thrown away because the $105,000 we'll spend now, another $5,000 or $8,000 to finish up this first phase. I'll call it two phases. When the second phase is done, by the cost of $50,000 or $60,000 in addition to this total amount. And you will be paying double the cost on behalf of this much.
Right, but we're gonna have to pay that again another time. So
I guess I was under the impression when we first started talking about this, we could save that if we waited. But we're not gonna save anything by waiting other than maybe
You can save the $50,000 or $60,000
if you save that amount. The second portion that you're going to pay can be saved if you want to wait another 5 years.
Oh, I just heard you say we're going to have to reset it again.
We will. We do it again. We can do it now. We'll do it again. That's for that $50,000 or $60,000.
I thought we'd have to do it anyway. Yes, now.
If we wait once, we can wait till this is all done, and then.
Right.
And then we won't. Then this will all be good 5-6 years from now.
Yeah.
But the downside of it is the people who can be taken out 3 years sooner and not pay the flood insurance. We went this far, and we can do the service for the residents that live in that floodplain. There was not a floodplain where a lot of people purchased the property there. There was not a floodplain designed by FEMA until
1960. The flood insurance program came in to be, so a lot of houses up along Magdalena and Doug and Memorial Courts were pre-flood insurance program.
And then when the flood map was updated, there were people removed from it, but there were more people put in it.
So we've already, at one point in time, we've already approved this. What you're asking for us tonight is to, you don't want to go through with it on your own.
I wanted the council's opinion and advice here. I've given you my opinion.
The only thing to think about is do it.
Or you may have a different makeup of a council 5 years from now that doesn't want to do it. We can still go forward with what we had, but it would be great when it not does the structure if they went through the same exercise that we're going through, but they don't. And they reiterated that in the meeting at least twice. They will not go through this exercise, but they replace the structure.
We've been very fortunate.
Yeah.
64.
Awesome. testimony. I said, if I was a property owner in that area and had already invested, might have approved that might be spent. And if I was one of these 60-some people, I said, why did you do this? We're paying 19%, up to 19% more each year in our flood insurance for the next 5 years.
Well, that's what really brought it to the forefront. Some people were doubling, and they just made the amendment late last summer, and only allowed to be 19, so. We've been waiting to have DNR's final review, because they've got to put their stamp on it before we can send it to FEMA. So, we just got DNR's final review, and it's ready to go to FEMA.
And one way I can come up with my decision is putting myself in the place of these residents that could be removed.
Seems like the bulk of it at this point, the FEMA study, I see no reason not to remove it, go on at this time. Notwithstanding, we may have to, we'll have to do something again later, but that's question.
So, Counselor, do you need a motion to do this? The Counselor approved it once.
Yeah, I think they approved the action. Continuation. Appears that you have it.
Flexible.
If you really want to, you ask for a formal motion.
Let's do that, but I think that's the third one that we can do. Entertaining motion for us to continue the gas paid floodplain. Turning in the. Submitting it to FEMA, but we've already decreased the floodplain level, so I can be mapped accordingly. And hopefully move people out of floodplain.
So moved.
Second. Any further discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Vote same side.
Aye.
Next item, I had to sign, I didn't have to, but I chose to. I found a good reason not to sign the peddler's permit last week. And we did receive at least one call on people peddling, and they had a right to, because I had signed the permit for it. And this just goes right along with what we brought up a few times in the past few years. Eliminating the door-to-door peddling. The last time this was addressed was in 1998. Times have changed. People do business differently. They do business on the internet. They jump in their car and they go to buy something someplace instead of somebody knocking on the door. I've addressed before that we have businesses in Greensburg that are trying to stay in business. It's unfair to them. There are situations where people come from out of state to peddle their goods without the back of the truck. Sometimes those are real good deals. The product may last forever, and it may go south real quick. That's just one of the reasons, my reasons for not wanting to have the issue with peddling permits. The other one is times have changed, society's changed. I don't want to put anybody sort of dangerous that would have to be, especially with my name. So I'd like to eliminate the peddlers going door to door. It does not affect
That's just the old ordinance, Mayor.
Yeah.
And then the new one is a copy.
The old ordinance in their package.
Yeah, we got the old.
The old one's in the package, it's not shaded red.
If any of the council members would like, I'm happy to transmit a track changes copy that shows the deletions. Essentially, what you'll see, because the mayor asked for my input in addressing this, is that so essentially the provisions that allow for the permit have been removed. And what I did is I clarified a little bit of language on the first section, section one, as far as kind of what the purpose behind this ordinance is, and then made several exceptions under section two that encompassed what I believe would be acceptable types of solicitations. For instance, I know there's an exception for campaigning, and there's one for nonprofits. Thanks. Realistically, there's also an exception for festivals, block parties. I mean, things that are otherwise approved here. You don't want to be able to. You don't want someone to say, well, you can't possibly sell things during Tree City Festival because there's an ordinance that says you can't sell things door to door or whatever. I mean, it's just, you know, we tried to put as many exceptions as we could, and then there's a penalty phase that authorizes some teeth to it and is authorized to be enforced by the Greensburg IN City Council. So it's really just cutting a lot of fat from the other ordinance and simplifying it down to the three sections.
I can tell you that in my experience and just general following stuff like this, it is a more routine practice to eliminate this type of salesmanship and this type of peddler's license. Some towns do have them. I have not done a specific survey of any of the towns in the area, so I can't give you a Russia does this, Carolina does that. But I do think that it is a less common practice to permit peddler's permits.
So it's more common if there is prohibited.
Yes.
There was a story in the news that last week, before last week, the city of Greenfield did something very similar to this. I see that.
I was on my way here at 6:18 and got a call from my wife and asked if I was knocking on the door. I pulled it up here, turned back around, went back, and then I saw a guy walking down the road. I waited, he came back. He had no identification, so he was checking to see if there was any work on our outdoors. And you know, it's dark here. It's dark at 6:18, and I guess this is his home right now. You know, I have a wife and two kids in the house, and it's scary.
I think safety reasons alone merits us looking at this.
Can we make one modification up in the title? It's misspelled Indiana. I think it was just a copy and paste of the old one. Is it misspelled it as well?
It's the new version.
We're going to go with that.
Oh, we're going to go with that. Okay.
This is going to be a. It's that number.
I would hope that we would be seen before one of them would be doing it in the other direction.
That's clear, probably.
Well, it's currently posed an offer to you, that's a bit.
Well, that's okay.
Whichever.
Not having, not being able to see that, or rather, this is clear, but, and I'm not opposed to making the change, right? Change is quite prudent. And I just, my question is whether or not it's even something that's enforceable, and how many other places do it or don't do it, how they enforce it. I guess I've got more practical kinds of questions about it rather than rushing into it. You know, for example, our definition of exemption, under the exemption section 2B, any administrators making sales of property in official capacity, so.
Well, that one.
That was a real one, I understand that, but what does administrators mean?
I'll tell you, that's a very good question. That is actually, of the ones that are in there, that's the one I didn't write. It was in your previously existing in 1995, so I included it to try and add continuity. I think you posed a very good question. I have no idea what it's intended to mean. But I will say, you know, generally speaking, it would be applied as any other ordinance interpretation, which means it would be given the general definition of those particular words if not specifically defined. But I'm with you, I could just as easily have stricken it and said, I don't know what that really means.
And any public officer or person making sales under any order or decree of the court?
The reason I included that one is because there are instances in which a court would order someone to go to a home. And I'm specifically thinking of an officer trying to serve a summons. I wanted to make sure that there was some exception to include clarity if someone was trying to serve a summons.
So tax sale and or a sheriff sale type.
Yeah, because it's not always an officer that has to do some of those things.
There's another one that I had forgotten about. It was last year that your legislative branch permit the cable companies to go forward without any sort of offense.
That's what raises, whether or not we make it prohibition or not, and then the enforcement of this is that the police can write a citation. And of course, it's the citation is 500 or not more than 1,000. So does the police officer have discretion of picking the number between 500 and 1,000?
I would think $500 and another state.
No, well, I'm not trying to be critical. I'm just trying to understand what we're actually saying we're going to have happen. So
I guess I took that to, when I read it, maybe I took it all wrong, but I took it as maybe you've got multiple people, and so they're all working for the same business. So you cite one here, and you cite one here, and you cite one here. So if you cite three of them, the fine can't be more than $1,000 a day, but maybe it's $500 per individual.
We have, you know, sometimes 12, 15 people. One person comes in to buy the permit. He does list his sales staff that's going to be out meeting on tours. There may be a dozen.
That's for the requirements now. Currently, that's for the requirement. They have to provide an ID and a copy of the permit.
How many permits have you signed in the last year? 2 years?
Oh, I'd say probably 15.
I was going to say a dozen, maybe.
No, last year.
One is active for a couple more days today. Tomorrow. It's over tomorrow.
The only time I recall getting very many
is
other than non for profits is during the type of tornado.
So here's
the same companies, that's the one that's down right now. They derive from that. That's how they came to Greensburg originally. They come back every year.
Who was maybe at my house?
I would say that was who was at your house.
But he needs to be able to show you a copy, try that again.
You want my information, I would do any of this information.
No, that's not acceptable. They're supposed to be providing you information, letting you know that they're allowed to do it.
Just like, if I signed a permit, if their board's the group, we have a person, wouldn't we be talking to your door?
And if they were, they could be fine.
You wouldn't be worried about your wife and kids either.
But I understand the mayor to be asking simply for it to be passed on first reading. I think you raised excellent points, Councilman Tebbit. There are some things that could probably be addressed and tweaked between first and second reading with regard to enforceability, to make that clear. My focus on it was more to say that there has to be some penalty or consequence that makes it so an officer can have a reason for speaking to that particular person.
And if you have concerns, email them to me. I will certainly address it before we communicate with you before the next meeting.
I don't know, I guess we have interest, whether or not maybe they can have a director's interest. That we see as a principle here, but in terms of, you know, maybe your assistant or somebody,
we can
find around, find out what the status is and the places, what kind of, if they do have ordinance or not, and if they do, what sort of ordinance is it?
As a person to do, and I can pick up on the mayor's down here, and with IAC, we can get all that.
Yeah, they say IAC will create another, like another source, and it might be helpful to get IAC to give us their best practice with regard to ordinances and or what their experience has been in places, just to get another perspective.